The frequency response of a microphone, a speaker, or a pair of headphones describes how the device responds to various frequencies. Looking at the frequency response of a device helps us understand the effect that device has on the frequency balance of signals passing through it. It gives us insight into the difference between the frequency balance of the signal at the input of the device versus the frequency balance at the output of the device. In addition to showing us the frequency range that a device is capable of passing, frequency response also illustrates the relative level of each frequency across the spectrum. This graph shows frequency on the x-axis from 20 Hz to 20 kHz and level on the y-axis in decibels, or dB. Let's say we send a perfectly balanced signal to the input of this device, where each frequency is equal in level. If the device has no impact on the signal's frequency balance whatsoever, the frequency balance at the output of the device would also be perfectly balanced. That would mean the device has a perfectly flat frequency response and would be represented on this graph with a perfectly flat line. On the other hand, if the device did alter the frequency balance of the signal, the frequency response graph for that device wouldn't be a flat line. It would instead show where the device attenuates or reduces the energy level at some frequencies, and where it boosts the energy level at other frequencies. I like to think of the frequency response graph as the EQ curve of a device. Any signal passing through the device will be subject to that frequency response curve, which can be a good thing or a bad thing, depending on the situation. When comparing the frequency response of different devices, it's important to consider the purpose of the device and the role it plays in your system. Sometimes flatter isn't necessarily better. For example, if I'm choosing studio monitors, headphones, or a D-to-A converter for mixing music, I'll probably look for something with a very flat frequency response. That's because I want something that alters the signal as little as possible. Otherwise, I may make mixing decisions based on the frequency response of my listening system rather than making decisions based on the actual frequency balance of the signal itself. In other situations, I might want a device that doesn't have a flat frequency response. Maybe I'm choosing a microphone that will help me capture a particular sound for a particular instrument. One example of this is the Shure Beta 52 microphone that has a frequency response uniquely tailored to recording kick drums. Again, I find it helpful to think of the frequency response as the EQ curve of a device. So if I'm choosing a microphone that will help my vocal cut through the mix at a live show, I might choose a mic with a subtle boost in the high mids or highs. If I want a mic that will tame the sound of a guitar amplifier, I might choose a mic that has a smoother response. So how do we measure frequency response? Well, one way to do it would be to send a test signal into a device that contains every frequency throughout the audible spectrum and measure the output of the device. This will help us understand the transfer function of the device, or the effect that the device has on the signal. Let's set up a test that demonstrates this process. I'll be using a software called QSIS that's used for custom programming in audio DSPs. Right here, I've set up a basic transfer function measurement. We've got a test signal of pink noise, and that pink noise is being split in two directions. One copy goes straight to our responsilizer as a reference, and the second copy goes through our device under test and into the measurement input of our responsilizer. The device under test in this case is simply a parametric equalizer, which currently isn't doing anything to the signal. So when we open our responsilizer, we can see that the transfer function of our device under test is pretty much a straight line. It has a flat frequency response. However, if I make an adjustment to the frequency balance of the signal, now there is a difference between the measurement input signal and the reference input signal. And we can see that difference shown here on this frequency response graph. So the transfer function of the device under test can be described by this graph. The same thing would happen if I added a high shelf, and the same thing would happen if I added a low shelf. So this graph tells us the effect that the device under test has. And the way this responsilizer knows that is because it has a raw, unchanged signal from our test signal generator and the output of our device under test, and can draw a comparison between those two and represent the difference on a graph. You could measure the frequency response of your own devices using an audio interface and a free software called Room EQ Wizard. There are a few factors I'd like to share with you that might affect the results of a frequency response measurement. especially a measurement that takes place in an acoustic environment. The first factor is the directionality of the microphone or speaker being measured. The specified frequency response of a microphone or speaker is generally describing the on-axis response. This means that the frequency response may vary if the microphone or speaker is pointed into a different direction, relative to the source or the listener. Microphones tend to sound darker when recording sound sources that are off-axis. Likewise, a speaker will sound darker to a listener who's off-axis to the high-frequency driver than it will to a listener who sits directly in front of the speaker. The second factor is the proximity effect. When using a directional microphone, you'll experience a bass boost as the microphone gets closer to the source. This, of course, affects the frequency response that you can expect from that microphone. I created a video that goes into much more depth on the proximity effect. It is a fascinating concept, so I'd recommend watching that video if you're interested in learning more. The third factor I want to share with you is the fact that every element of the signal chain will have a frequency response. That's why it's so important to set up tests that isolate the particular device you're testing. For example, measuring a microphone's frequency response by blasting a test signal through a low-quality speaker into an acoustically untreated room will not yield accurate results. The results will not only include the frequency response of the microphone, but also the frequency response of the speaker and the frequency response of the room itself. Everything has a frequency response, and our goal is to be as aware as possible of the effect that each component within our system has and use that knowledge to achieve the desired results. One of the biggest obstacles holding you back is probably the frequency response of your room. So I'd recommend watching this video that will show you how to optimize your room for critical listening and recording. I'll see you over there.